Okay, thank you, Eduardo. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hello, yes. So last speaker today is Hans van den Winkler from Lionics International.
I have to remember my password first. This is something is blocked here. All right, all set. Pascal, thanks first for inviting me to this nice workshop. And when you called me, I couldn't tell that I wouldn't be CEO anymore of Lionics. So you said, what do you have to put on your name? And so I said, I don't know. Might do something, but not CEO of Lionics, because I just stepped down. That at that time, I couldn't tell you, but I'll tell you the reason why. And that's a 20-year history with some lessons to be learned or some things to be remembered. And things are already in the name. And we started out as Lion Photonics, and now we're called Lion International. It's still blue. And I'm not CEO anymore, I do some strategic business advisor, which is a nice job. As Pim said, you don't have to take care of everything, only a few things you like. And that's the nice thing. We started in 2000, and 2000 was a good year. Why? Because I was working in the Netherlands, and I didn't like my job anymore. I moved already quite a lot before that during the world, but my family said, no, we want to stay now. Kids are already getting older. If you want to go, go somewhere, but we stay in the city where we live. So that's a problem. So what do you do then? No companies available where you can work. You start your own company. Easy as it sounds. But it was quite easy because I met René Heidemann, which everybody knows pretty well, a well-known scientist at the time, and working on integrated photonics already at the University of Twente. And he said, yes, Hans, there's opportunity here at the university. We have technology available. But I don't know what to do with it. I said, now perhaps I have a solution for you. There's a telecom hype ongoing, big, huh? And as I came out of CSM in Switzerland, where we were a technology provider, I said, why don't we provide technology to that community? We have great technology in Twente. Let's offer that to our customers and start doing business. Straight. Need some money, huh? So we needed some equipment, because when we bought equipment, we could screw out a few other companies in the environment which used the same equipment. So we created our own customers right away. So we got some money for that, put our own money in. And we also acquired IP from the university. Not that it was well after 20 years said that we shouldn't have done. On the other hand, the investors which we met during the last 20 years all like IP. I don't know why, because patents as a small company is the freedom to operate. But they like to put a lot of value on a patent, which is, if you have a few, nice to have. If a university is willing to give you a license on it, just take it, because investors love it. Because that's the only thing with, in high tech which you really think it's tangible value for a company. They can take patents away, but they can't take people away. So lessons learned over the last 20 years. If you want to have a startup, take care that you really have IP and pay for it. So 2016, and we made a nice logo, a nice lion. Yeah? It was healthy animal, nice colors. And then we said, what a strategy. We supply technology to our AM customers. We are horizontally integrated. We only do the chips and the rest we don't care about. Somebody else has to do it. And we maintain technology leadership by securing a strong IP position, which we were very good at. The time was right. If you look at the graph in 1999, the NASDAQ went up sky high. So starting a company in 2000 was very worthwhile. Everything was possible. The problem was that 6 months later, the drop was already there. So we were sitting there with a company that said, something is not happening. All our customers, we had, after 2 months we were started, we already had customers sign contracts and so on and so forth. Only within 8 months, 12 months later, they didn't pay their final bills. They were gone, they were disappearing, so nothing happened. So then we had to say, okay, what to do now? Close the company would have been one option, but we had a good technology. And I'm also more experienced in MEMS than in optics, so we said we can also do going to MEMS activities, we can do sensors, because we have the technology available. As a technology provider, you can shift your gears, shift a bit late your attention on your marketing and sales, and then you can continue. What we also learned in this thing is that you have to jump ahead. Hedge your bets is if you're going to the MEMS world and you only have optical people at that time in your company, it's not very good. Either you fire them or find a new one, or you try to get people in. So we acquired part of a company, 3T, which was specialized in MEMS acquisition. And MEMS application. So that's nice. But there we needed, of course, cash. So we had to do a second round of investment. But as we still had enough cash available at that time, because some of the customers paid, but not the last bill, but we were expensive in the beginning, of course, booming market. So we had time and money to arrange this, this deal, get the money around, and then is something which can happen. So if you have cash, don't be worried and follow the market, so be flexible. Even if you're a technology provider, you have to follow the trends. Where is the most attention? Whose company is willing to pay for technology development? So 3T came in. Yeah, when new people come on, you get one new investor on board, you have to change color, a little bit of logo, because that's everybody likes. But we kept the lion in, of course, and we added Lionix. Why, I don't know still, but it sounded very good at the time. So we came into an organic growth profile, technology provider. Not a good time because there was the financial crisis, there was not much money around, and there were startups coming up with not enough money, and they start paying in shares. As we were still profitable, we have been every year during 20 years making a small profit. We had time and money to spend on new companies with new ideas. And they paid a little, and we bought shares of that. We also developed some product ideas, early phase, much too early, probably. We looked at the market and said, this is a bright idea. Let's start company. So we started Phoenix Software, well known. It's now owned by Synopsys. But that was in 2002 we started Phoenix Software. Because even then we thought photonic integration will come back. But we need good software to do that. Companies disappeared. If you need software ourselves, let's develop it. But if you develop only software for yourself, it's a very narrow basis, very expensive. So let's make a company out of it who sells, writes the software which we need and sells it to other people. So we always at the forefront of the new software in optics, which was nice to have because you can also define what's going on. And that helped a lot in developing the integrated photonics technology. But we went also in Capillix was electrophoresis measurement and chemistry with Chemtrix, which is one of the biggest companies now in the world in flow chemistry, although very small, but it's one of the biggest ones. So technology push continued in integrated photonics, and then we developed the triplex technology. The first patent there was already in 2004, which is a little bit strange. If you look at the development in integrated photonics market, nothing happened during those years. 2000 to 2001, not much happened in development in integrated photonics. But we started that, and it was mainly paid for by subsidized project. European Union was very nice. At that time, the Netherlands was very nice still, but the last 5 years, there's no money available for grants in the Netherlands. So we could build up our IP portfolio. And what we learned also, and that I knew already a little bit before, if you have subsidy providers, don't see them as giving money and then walk away, but treat them as customers, because you will need them again in the future. There are also project officers who can determine on your next projects. There are partners inside projects who rely on you. So project subsidy is really a customer, nothing else than another customer. And basically, the only thing we have to provide in these customers is an effort. They can never ask for results, but you only have to show that you put an effort in. So if you do that, then you can be very well, very successful in getting grants. A few other companies which we thought up was interesting was when we had developed this integrated photonics a little bit more, we went into the visible light. We thought, there's some good opportunities in visible light treatment, so let's start a company, Xaya Photonics, which will deal with lasers and laser combinations and laser light combinations. And another company we thought at the same time was Setrex. 5G, my gosh, 2009, we were much too early. We had an idea about 5G, wonderful. Optical beamforming networks based on integrated photonics. Look wonderful, nice specs, but there was no market which we figured out. We started thinking about putting them not on airplanes or satellites, but putting them on boats. It's a nice market because boats need interconnection. But we figured out that all the boat manufacturers, even yachts, they were not interested in investing money into a development. So you had to do it all by yourself. So that's we faced a hard time to raise money. So these companies were part of Lionex, also funded by other investors. We talked a lot with them, and then we went a little bit in problem because 2010 around was the next financial crisis. If you remember the previous one, there was a nice dip and another dip, which means money was short. So we had to slow down our own product development within Xaya Photonics and also within Setrex, because cash is tight. If you want to survive, you reduce cost. No way to get investors in, especially when the market is delayed. There was no market for 5G. There was a market for light engines at that time, but also there, it was a disruptive technology we proposed, integrated photonics compared to free space optics. People had a big problem to shift from one to the other. And that's where it's also, when we talked to the previous speaker, the product development takes time, especially if you have a new product, disruptive technology, new market. Expect at least 8 to 12 years before you have a product developed. And then even then you're really lucky. If it's the second generation, it's much faster. Then you can do it in 2 to 3 years, you have the second generation. But the first one takes a lot of time, costs more money, and disruptive technology takes a lot of convincing. When we started Phoenix software, we said we need to have PDKs. It's now a well-known word. When we started it up, we had to preach that there's some need for people doing their stuff. Nowadays, it's normal that you have multi-project wafer. At Lionex, we have now run 20 running in multi-project wafers. It's more and more efficient. When we started that 15 years ago, nobody wanted to have it. It's too complex to address it. But if we wouldn't have started then, we wouldn't have done it now. So 2012, 2016, increase in integrated photonics. We had our triplex technology, we had over 25 patents filed. The Xaya Photonics visible light applications was doing well, and they were also more and more specialized in assembly and packaging because, as you all well know, the smaller the wavelengths, the more difficult to assemble. And they really got some experience there, which could never be had for. Setrex, system engineering for telecom, microwave photonics, a lot of interest came up. But all of these customers were looking at us and said, you have Lionex does design, manufacture chips, Setrex does the system, Xaio does assembly packaging. Who I'm dealing with? I said, yeah, it's me, because I had a different hat on my head. But it didn't fly. So we said, okay, if you really want to have one-way stop for every customer, we need going from chips into modules into systems, so we need to offer them as a customer, as a provider. And secondly, another problem was that mass volume was envisioned. Not directly, that's the problem, because you also make first a few prototypes and then takes X months of time, X years before you're in mass volume production. So how to survive that area? And the question there was, and I said, I don't know, don't mind, within 2 years we can build a fab where you can produce these chips. But that was, of course, not enough as an answer. You really had to have an outlook for big customers. So we were at the forefront of integrated photonics. We had a problem with customers. They wanted to have a one-way stop. So we decided to integrate Lionx, Xio, and Cetrox into one company called Lionx International. And for mass volume manufacturing, we needed investment. As a small company, you cannot afford to do that. So either you look for partners or you look for a lot of money, but at least you have to do something to satisfy your customers. Even if they don't order 10 million pieces, they want you to be able to show that you can do it. Very important that you have an outlook in mass volume production. So we went through different cycles. And again, another color. And the other color was not by chance, because in Asia, they like red. And we put international there to show that we work worldwide. So at the same time, integrated photonics, as I said, was more and more interesting. So some data, more wireless users, market analysis came up, nice reports, everything was booming again, like in the end of 90s for the telecom hype, but it started a little bit again. But it's now reality. It's more confirmed that data will grow, smart industry will use. Big markets came up. Data explosion, everybody knows. All our kids, at least my kids and my grandchildren, want more and more content and at the same time, and not wait 10 seconds to have it downloaded. But if it's not there in 1 second, they're already, woo, daddy or granddad, help me. So we need disruptive technology, which can only be delivered by integrated photonics. Also, other applications came up. Virtual reality, artificial experience, video on demand, online gaming, which is, if you look at sometimes online gaming, it's getting a big industry. You can get millionaire when you can play a good online game. Well, just like a good tennis player, a good soccer player. But these are markets, I don't see them, but my kids do. But I don't know how you are looking at it. But sometimes there's a huge e-games is really, really getting annoyed. And they all need data in interconnection. And they need also help with visualization. So that's where integrated photonics can help in the visual domain, which is, in my view, a very big, big market. So booming market, that's what we knew, that's what we said. And then we said, if we need mass volume manufacturing, which we can offer, this because the markets I showed is only mass volume, you have to have a solution for it. You have to be able to deal with those things. So people came up, we looked for partnerships, we looked for investors, and suddenly two Korean companies came up. One was a private equity company, and the other one was a stock-listed market in LED displays, in electronics. They wanted to move forward in integrated photonics. They believe in integrated photonics. So they bought Lionx International, which was nice for the shareholders. I'm one of them, so it was very nice. But it's also very good for our customers. Scalable production became available. So instead of horizontal integration, we were able to offer vertical integration of our product. So that's the only thing which we changed in our logo and our mission from horizontal to vertical. Closing these deals, and I had a lot of experience in the Netherlands with setting up small companies and so on, also in the US and in the UK. Doing business in China, in Korea, is something completely different. I figured out that they always say yes, but when they mean no, or they say no, and then you don't know why they say no, because they never say no. Something to be learned. And also I learned that personal contact is essential to doing business in Korea or China. You have to meet with people, you have to look them into the eyes, you build up a kind of trust. That's very essential. And if you're a little bit older, it's easier, especially in Korea. And locally, you need somebody who can represent you, that you really completely trust, because he can explain to you what you should or shouldn't do, or what some remarks would mean from people in front of you. Because most of the time, the people you talk to don't speak good English, or not at all. So they have co-workers who speak English, but they don't say anything. So you have official translators, but they don't translate exactly what you say. They translate it sometimes in Dutch, they're very harsh and direct and so on. So they make it a nice story, but then you don't know what the other partner knows. And that's why you need somebody locally who speaks very well English, which is on your side, And really, you can trust what he means, what the interpretation should be from all these kinds of things. If that's done, then we had quickly a deal. We shook hands very fast. And then the process starts, because then you get a letter of intent, and then you get an MOU, and you get all kinds of legal documents. The thing you have to learn there is that you don't let lawyers take over. Lawyers are very good, especially if you are hiring external law firms, especially if both parties do that, eh? So the seller and the buyer. And then these guys have a field day. That's wonderful, because they do everything to be in favor of you, and the other guy does everything to be in favor of the buyer. But that's not the meaning. If you do this kind of deals, it's a strategic investment. It's not about calculation, so much EBITDA, 2 to 3 times the turnover. It's about the total value. And lawyers don't understand that, basically. They don't believe in it. So let them do their job, but keep in charge. If you let them go out and say, yeah, let me see your finished document and negotiate with the other party, it will not happen. So sometimes, again, you have to go back to your champion, say, let's cut the bullshit of all these lawyers. What do you really want to do? Put it on paper and let them phrase it in the right way. And also, that's the thing which you really have to learn, and that's the thing I have was most profitable in everything I did, is be able to walk away. If it's not under your conditions and not what you want, you have to say no, which means it's not easy. So if you have enough cash in the bank and you're a profitable company, you can walk away. If you're tight squeezed or your investor starts screaming, you have to sell because we want to get out, then as a director, you're screwed, because you have parties pushing you around, which is not good. And have plan A, B, and C in parallel. But sometimes you have to disappoint the guys in plan B. Be honest, tell the other guy was first, and that's it. But tell them always that something is going on. Very, very important. So strategy of Lionx International is vertical integration. It's the only thing I changed. Eh? So in 20 years, we only changed this word. But we changed focus in OEM and technology. Eh? Sometimes it's more integrated Photonics, sometimes with a little bit more MEMS, but we are technology providers and technology lovers, so that's easy to do. And keep on collecting IP. Applications, where we now sit, is the most things which we perfectly know, but my personal thing which I really believe in as big market is disposable sensor chips via light source integration. So on the left-hand side, you see a chip that's a biosensor, but where we integrated already the light source, a VCSEL, you can't see it, it's 200 by 200 micron, flip chip on top of this big chip. There's a detector, so everything integrated. So this is disposable sensor chip, which in volumes you can measure between 20 and 100 parameters, if you have the right biochemistry. That's if you have the right biochemistry. And that will cost less than $1 in volumes. All done, all developed, but we never made a million. But we have the technology and proved the principle that you can make a million. The middle is the tunable lasers for sensing. Nice hybrid combinations of triplex and indium phosphide. And we have our microwave photonics. That's the product which we better should call 6G at the moment. It's a complete OBFN, optical beamforming network. And just to show, this is the laser. But this, when we started with Setrex, this was our optical beamforming network. It was a huge box in polystyrene plastic. And there's a small chip on the right side, and all the rest was a lot of transpiration. But it's not a solution. It's not an integrated photonic solution. But in 2018, this is the integrated photonic solution. So we have everything on the chip. We can connect modulators and detectors right to the chip. And the only fiber you see on the right side is still a fiber connected. It's only for analysis and testing. The final product won't have any fiber. Right? It will be RF in, RF out. But all the other things will be optical. So this is nowadays the state of the art, and now we are really got traction from the market and get nice project and customer orders in to start developing. Because these things can be modified to customer needs. So the optical beamforming network is what you need, is what you get. And there's not one, because every telecom provider has different demands on what they want to do. So we can adapt that technology and put it in a package, which is a big step from the 2007 to the 2018. Cost also a lot of money, but luckily there were some subsidizing grants available and still are in Europe to develop this technology further. Lessons learned also, if you look at this development from 2007 to 2018, that packaging is crucial. Assembly and packaging is in my view, more important than nowadays producing a chip, an integrated photonic chip. It's more difficult, there's more skills involved and not developed yet. And if you want to be vertically integrated, and we could do it inside, but we also figured out that you need a different skill set in people. If you do assembly and packaging, it's completely different than you make it the newest design on an integrated circuit. And develop technology in a clean room is completely different than in an assembly and packaging line. So we created FIX, assembly and packaging, which is also not only for Lionex, but mainly also for other customers. It's working up, and I think in the Netherlands can be lucky that we have two sites where you can order assembly and packaging of photonic devices, because I don't think anywhere else in Europe these capabilities are. And if you think about the Korean shareholders we have, they also thought it was a good idea to develop that not only in Korea, but primarily first in the Netherlands. If it really goes off and it's working, then we can duplicate the same production line in Korea, because they're good in duplicating and setting it up. Then we can serve the Asian market out of Korea, and we can do the European market, American market out of Europe. So there's no discrepancy between volume manufacturing. And I believe that in Europe, we have to get volume manufacturing back inside Europe. And I think also price-wise, we can be competitive if we do the right thing in an efficient way, because salaries was always the big issue, the big difference. I think salaries in Korea are getting higher, as high as here in the Netherlands, especially for specialists. Also in China, you see salaries goes up. So in the long run, it's more about who has the good equipment and automation than who has the cheapest labor. For the biosensors, there was an even a bigger problem. Because if you talk about biosensors, again, I think 8-10 years ago, the biosensor had a photonic basic sensor was known. The Magina interferometer, the ring resonator, Young interferometer. Now it's getting quiet. That's the difficulty with biosensors. It's very difficult. Then it's get quiet all along. Because what you have to do is you have a biosensor, which is a general word. But compared to acceleration and temperature and velocity, that's easy things, because biosensors, there are a million of pieces you have to measure, or you can measure. The different applications, everybody wants to measure something very specific and very precise. For that, you need not only a good sensor principle, but also you have to get your biomarker on top of your biosensor. And it's easy to just put it on, then you have a 90% nice result. You have very good publications. You can publish forever. Look at the gas sensors, for example. But it's not product. Product is only comes when it's reliable, repeatable, you have a good shelf life, and then you can only do when you have good chemistry involved. So that's why we created Surfix, a company with completely different skills, all chemists. And from origin, I'm a chemist, so I could understand what they're talking about, but I was the only one in the company. Surface modification is difficult, and then you have the biomedical application. So our goal is to have Surfix as an outlet for biosensors, whereby our customers will provide the specific target and market they want to provide to their issue. And that's why, because we are first the Holland Integrated, we get integrated everything. I spin out two companies again, because from the culture point of view, it doesn't fit. And different skills at different people, they can't talk to each other. So we decided to make a few more companies still again. So it seems to me that that's it. So this is how it looks like at the moment. We are in the gallery. We have the packaging close by. We have the gallery where we can small and medium volume manufacturing. And then we can go to Korea when we have chip manufacturing in high volumes. So some summary, 20 years of dealing with technology, dealing with investors, dealing with products. What did I learn? New products takes a lot of time. So if you have a startup, you want to start your company, be patient. It takes time, not only to make your product, but also to sell it and let it be accepted into the market. be flexible because the market you envision can disappear or can change. So you have to change the direction of your product. If it doesn't work, do something else. But if you have the right people and the right culture inside your company, you can manage that. Also, your investors will be loyal to you, at least in Europe. If you have an outlet, an outview that you can do something different, but that opportunity is gone, you can go for the next one, then they will believe you and stick with you. In high tech, people are your assets. Treat them well, make a culture that they don't walk away. That's everybody has to do it as in his own manner. It shouldn't be made up, it should be real and lively, and then you also attract the people who belong to you. So that's also the very important thing. You form big teams which still stick together. If you look at cash, cash is king. If you don't have cash in the bank, basically you're screwed. If you want to do product development, you can't pay for the next integration run or for a new equipment or whatever, you're dead. Because your development time goes down, competition comes up, so that's something which you do. So raise money on time, not when you need it. So the thing is, I had a discussion with the bank. You can get credit lines from a bank, and they can only give you credit lines when you have enough money in the bank. Then it's easy, it takes you 2 weeks to ask for an essential credit line. If you need money, it takes 6 months to ask for a credit line. Then you're bankrupt. So do it as fast as possible, and it gives you also time. You're not that much distracted from your day-to-day work. Investors love IP, even if I don't like it. I always said, let's get all the IP which we can get, because at the end it will pay off. And with an exit, stay in control, not your investors. Get professionals on board, like a lawyer, a notary, accountant. Very important people, because there are a lot of tricks and hicks in all financial statements. Notary can help you very much to be able to deal with it, especially if you have a good notary. For example, between Korea and the Netherlands, there's a big difference in the legal system. So the nice thing is, when we signed in Korea the chair purchase agreement, then when we were at the airport, there was also a press release out of the company. And for us, we had to wait 3 days because the notary had to sign the document. Then it would have been legal for us. But so we were sitting in the plane and said, okay, in 5 days' time, you have to make a press announcement. And during our ride home, we already got emails and apps from people, hey, you sold your company, what's happening? And even our employees didn't know from anything. So be aware that these are different, really different things, and difficult to understand why that's going on. Takes also a lot of time, probably 3 to 6 months to close a deal. And that time is tough, because you don't know if it goes on. Pim told that a lot of failure can happen at the last moment until the signature is there and the money is in the bank. That's even more important. Then you have a deal. So don't let it influence your decisions. Just keep doing what you did already. Don't change. I can't talk to that customer because perhaps that will come up. Just do what you have to do, because that's the best thing to do. And then create also freedom to walk away. It was my personal idea. If I sell the company, normally you have a lock-in period, and I got rid of it. So I'm free to walk away. That's nice. Because that made it possible for me. So even after 1.5 years, I said I want to do something else. So I prepared my successor, Anna Leinzer, well known, I think, already. He was already working for more than 10 years within the company, but he's now CEO of Lionex. And I can follow up my own passion again, and that's create new products with new startups and new people. So getting young people on board is nice. So I did. The last year and a half, I did Qwix, quantum photonics, computing based on integrated photonics. And also I've founded a company together with a Chinese friend of mine and René Heidemann, of course, to sell hybrid lasers in China, develop them and sell them there. So that means even if we sold the company, already had freedom to operate, to create something new from my investors. I'm very thankful for them, and that's why I'm still supporting Lionex. So that's 20 years, and now it's open for questions and answers.
Thank you, Hans. So, questions? At the back, by Jose Pozo. In the meantime, I will ask a question myself. You mentioned that you got the champion in Korea. How did you do that?
I first went there on a mission from the Dutch government, economical mission, where they showed us around quite a number of people. I met a few people, and there we connected. We had a good drinks somewhere, and then it turned out to be the champion. Yeah. So the Dutch government helped in that area a lot.
Okay. Thank you. Then Jose.
Yeah, my question is about fix. You said that doing the assembly of a photonic chip is as difficult as getting it fabricated. Do you see also perhaps a gap in the value chain when it comes to the testing of those chips? Is there a place where companies can actually get those chips tested? And is that something you want to follow up with perhaps your next IX company?
I think testing alone will not be a company in itself. Because that's too relying on specifications. It's not a general market. I think every product has to be tested separately, and a test team has to be set up. So the guy who does packaging assembly has also do the testing. That's what's going to happen. And perhaps in 20 years, when the market is mature, testing can be separate. But at the time, I don't see it.
Okay, so we are closing the session now, and then we have several activities for this 1 hour and a half before the welcome reception. So we will be again at the business-to-business meetings. So for those that are engaged on this, please follow us, which are Alpheon Photonics, Panasonic, VMBG, and Ligand Tech, Chip Nano Imaging, VLC, Fila, and IBM.
And Lionics.
Well, and Lionics as well, yes. And then for the others, either you can go for a walk to the beach maybe, or you can just follow part of our group to visit the laboratory and the clean room. So everything will be organized on the floor below. Thank you.
Me lo llevo para allí.
Vale, pues me voy contigo.